Hello again, everybody. This is Dan Clouser, and welcome back to the Journey of My Mother's Son podcast. Today, I'm joined with fellow full-time RVers, Pat and Alex, who also go by the tag name on Instagram, RV Party of Three. Guys, thanks for joining me today. Really appreciate it.
Thanks for having us.
Yeah, thank you so much. We appreciate the invite.
No problem. I always like connecting with like-minded people, people who are crazy enough to, kind of tell society that, the paying property taxes and living in a bricks and sticks house isn't for them and traveling the country. And for you guys to be doing it at such a young age, I just think is incredibly awesome. So really looking forward to the conversation and, listening to, what inspired you. And hopefully between all of us, we can inspire some other people to say, you don't have to do it the way society is telling you how to do it. There's other ways to go about living this life, and it can be much more fulfilling and much, much more enjoyable. So to get started, tell me a little bit about whose idea was it for you guys? Did it take some convincing of the other party, or was it like an aha moment where it was like, hey, man, let's go buy an RV and do this thing?
I think it was probably an aha moment and a little bit of a mutual thing. We each really wanted to do it, and we kind of just kept egging each other on, giving each other reasons to do it, and it sounded better and better, and then we finally were like, let's go for it.
Stars aligned, everything started working out perfectly to where it was actually possible, and we just started making it happen. And I would just tell people, just do it, because we had no idea what we were doing. We just started doing it, and yep. It worked.
Yeah.
That is awesome. That's awesome. Now, did you guys do like a bunch of camping, a bunch of RVing while you were growing up with your families, or was it, pretty much all new to you?
I grew up camping. I'd been in a couple campers, but never like a motorhome. And then I think he grew up tent camping, but had never been in any kind of camper or motorhome at all. So It was kind of new to us, but we knew that we wanted to live in it full time. So we wanted to be able to either get a Class A or a Class C rather than the truck and camper combo. So that's kind of where we started. And then we looked at a few of them, and this one seemed perfect for us. And the salesman did a really good job of making us feel pressured. And it was like, you got to get it right now. Like, a bunch of people are looking at it. It's a really good deal. So we're like, okay, let's just get it. So we just did.
just went for it.
That's cool. And then I want my listeners to understand that you guys did a lot of renovations to that RV as well. So let's talk a little bit about the renovation process and what all was involved. And from what I understand, you guys did it pretty on a pretty good budget.
Yes, budget was definitely one of our top concerns. It is a 2010 Forest River Sunseeker, so it's a little bit on the older side. Well, not too old, but the interior was a little dated, so we definitely wanted to freshen it up a little bit. Started with the paint. Did a demo first. Got everything out of there that we didn't want in there, and then just started painting pretty much everything. All the walls, cabinets, trim pieces, white, and that opened it up a little bit. We laid some peel and stick vinyl floor, some peel and stick backsplash and countertops, and that was pretty much it.
I'll give him props. Him and a friend of ours replaced the awning. What's the thing called?
The awning tarp.
Yes, they replaced the tarp themselves.
Oh, cool.
So that's pretty cool, because we've been told that that's kind of a difficult thing to do. So that was kind of cool thing that they did. We got new tires and new batteries and things like that. We didn't do anything super crazy
mechanically.
Yeah, that's cool. I mean, but you did pretty much gut the entire RV for the most part, to an extent. So I think replacing the awning probably, regardless how challenging people might have told you it was, is probably like, if we did all this stuff, we can do the awning too.
Oh, yes.
Definitely. And we should say also that we did 98% of the renovations from a storage facility with no hookups or running water or anything like that. So bringing out gallons of water and buckets to wash the paintbrushes in and all that kind of stuff. It was definitely a process, a weekend project for about 3 months.
Yeah, we would spend, 8 hours a day on the weekends because we were still working full time. So we would go out on the weekends and spend all of our time out there. And giving credit where it's due, we had a lot of help from friends and family too, so couldn't have done it without them.
That's cool. Was there any point during the renovation process where you went home at night and looked at each other and were like, man, what are we doing?
I think.
Definitely early on when before it started to come together and it was just looked like a mess in there and there's stuff everywhere. There's definitely those moments where
I've never painted before. I've never painted a room. And he has like a painting background a little bit. So when I said we should paint everything white, like let's make everything white, he looked at me like I was crazy. And he's like, are you sure?
And I'm looking at all the little nooks and crannies and trim pieces and
outlets and everything. And once we started it, I was like, okay, well, we're already started. So we got to do it now. But it was a lot. Glad we did it, but it was a lot more than I expected.
Yeah, that is very cool. And I do want to point out to my listeners that, the other thing we have in common as opposed to, just being full-time RVers is we actually both drive Sunseekers, which is pretty cool. And, for those not in the RV world, the Class C and the Class A, the Class C has the bunk above the cab and is a little bit more like a glorified van, so to speak. What made you guys want to, go Class C as opposed to Class A?
Really, it was just the specific RV. We had a couple things, but like we just loved this. The Sunseeker has so many windows. That's a big thing. And we like how we have like a hallway. I don't know if they're all exactly the same, but we have a hallway and it makes the bedroom feel separate from the living space, which typically you would think would make it feel smaller in here, but it almost makes it feel bigger. Like there's two separate spaces when he's working in here. I'm in the bedroom. It's like we're in two different rooms. So it's, I like it.
Yeah, definitely. We're definitely looking at price originally and just the area that we were looking at. It seemed like the Class C's were a little bit less in price. And then we heard from a few people just they're a little bit easier to maneuver around and park in different places. So with us doing so much traveling and different, relocating, we wanted to, make it as easy. Parking it and stuff.
Yeah, and that's very much the reason why we, went with a Class C as well. Is, we never, drove an RV before we drove this thing off the lot. And sometimes a Class A can look a little intimidating, so to speak. And it's always better to start smaller and then go bigger as opposed to, going out and buying the, 44 foot Class A and then decide, wow, this is a little tough to handle. Let's trade it in on the Class C. That definitely doesn't work out financially in that regard.
No.
But we love the Sunseeker as well. It's like you said, ours is 33 feet, which is just, 2 foot bigger than what you guys are driving. But, there's really not a time where we look around and we're like, man, we're really cramped here. Actually, I lie. There was one time when we went camping with our grandkids and our daughter, and there were five of us in this thing, plus the dog. So there are some times there where I was looking around saying, yeah, this is a little cramped. But for just just the three of us, we're in good shape. So it is pretty cool. So what's one of the things, you guys have been doing it now for 4 months. Is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
So you're both still working full-time jobs, working remotely, which is cool, which is something I think, I want, the listeners to understand that this isn't something that you need to be independently wealthy to do. In our situation, I'm still working and published a couple books and that sort of stuff. But, it's not like Sandy and I are sitting on this huge mountain of cash and just, traveling around the country. And I want, people to understand that that's not the case. And especially if there's a silver lining to COVID, it's proving that pretty much everything in the world for the most part can be done remotely. So as you were kind of going into that process, what type of, you know, conversations did you have with your employers to say, look, this is what we're doing? And how receptive were they to, you know, allowing you to do it?
Well, part of our stars aligned situation when we decided to do the RV thing was that I got hired June of 2020. So right in the middle kind of quarantine for a completely remote work from home position with, you know, no need in the future to be in the office, just totally work from home. And so that was one of the main factors that we thought we could do this. The only thing was asking Alex's employers if it would be cool with them. But after we decided to get the RV, I pretty much just talked to my supervisor and asked if it would be all right. And she said that, you know, as long as you have solid internet connection and you can log on and you'll be available. Yeah. I don't see why not. You know, they were actually a little jealous and excited that I was able to do that. So,
and my job, they thought about it for a few weeks. So it was a little scary because I was like, we really want to do this. And if they don't support it, you know, we might not be able to. But after a couple weeks of thinking about it, they came back and said, like, you know, we'd love to have you. We'll manipulate your position so that, you know, we can work remotely. And it's worked out great.
Mm-hmm. Everyone's been so supportive and happy for us and excited on our journey. So we're just super grateful to have everyone in our lives and support us. So it's been great.
It's cool. So how about family and friends when you first started telling them, you know, because again, I know the reaction we got, it went from everywhere to like, man, that's the coolest thing I ever heard of, to have you guys completely lost your mind. So what was the spectrum as you guys were breaking the news to friends and family about it?
I would say the spectrum is pretty
consistent. Everyone
was, I was going to say wide.
Why? I don't think we had anyone who thought we were crazy.
No,
I didn't. I feel like everyone's been super supportive and excited. Maybe like asking why, and if they assume we're not working, then they're like, oh no, what are you doing? Mm-hmm. But when they find out we're working, I guess they're like, oh, perfect. Like, go have fun.
People thought we were just cashing unemployment checks or something and doing that. And we happily told them that, nope, we're still working full time and, you know, being able to enjoy it. So most of it, everyone was happy for us.
Yeah, that's cool. That is so cool. What have some of the biggest challenges been for you guys? You know, living full time and working, obviously.
The dog, our dog Chief, he is our, you know, third party, but he doesn't like travel days. He gets really, really anxious, very bad, you know, anxiety. We have to give him some doggy CBD sometimes. That's probably the biggest issue that we have, I'd say. And then the only other thing is that we feel like we want to do all of these things, but we still have to work. So we have to do things in the evenings and do things on the weekends, but the weekends are really the only time we can travel. So we have to try to, that's our biggest hurdle right now, I think, is trying to manage everything, time management, planning our trips accordingly so we can still go do things and explore, but we still have to work. So we got to plan around that.
And all the other things like, you know, not being able to do laundry whenever we want. We don't have a washer or dryer in here. Getting used to a little bit smaller of a shower. Things like that kind of came pretty naturally. We didn't have, there wasn't too much of an issue adjusting to that. I will say that leveling at different campsites, getting the RV level takes us a decent amount of time.
It's a little bit of couples therapy.
Yeah, a little bit of couples therapy. We're getting better at it, but we've changed leveling systems. We originally had the little like Lego blocks, and now we just use 2x8s pieces of wood that we got from Lowe's because they're a little bit wider, a little bit more surface area. But that's pretty much it. If we ever get another one, it's definitely going to have an automatic leveling system.
Well, I can speak from a guy who's got the automatic leveling system. It's it's worth whatever you spend on it.
I imagine it is. Oh yeah, definitely.
But it's still, you know, you still have to be on a relatively level surface to start, you know. Let's face it, I mean, the first campground we'd actually stayed in was in Lynchburg, Virginia, and we kind of bit off a little bit more than we could chew on our first day of travel, as we really, you know, shouldn't have gone as far as we did. We started out north of Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and traveled down into Lynchburg, Virginia, via Skyline Drive and the Shenandoah Parkway, or Skyline Drive and the Blue Ridge Parkway. So it's not like you're cruising at, you know, 65 miles an hour through there, you know. So we go rolling into this campsite at, you know, 7:15 in late August. So it's, you know, we got basically 20 minutes of daylight to, you know, literally set up the camper for the first time. And our site was not level, and, you know, we had it jacked up on blocks. So even with the leveling system, you know, it took some work that first time. So, but it's still much easier than what you guys are going through. I can guarantee that.
Yeah,
it really is a press of the button, and, you know, you look in and you say, all right, honey, put the slides out. So it's definitely pretty sweet deal. So, I kind of forgot with you guys in the 2010 that you're probably weren't at the automatic leveling system at that point.
Yeah, we've definitely looked at each other and said, is it worth, because we looked up how much it would be to install one. It's probably around $3,000 to $5,000. And we looked at each other and said, is it worth it? Should we do it? Or should we just
deal with it? We're still not sure. But one day, maybe.
We're getting better at it. It doesn't take nearly as long as it originally did. But, you know, I had never been in an RV. I'd never stepped foot in an RV before I stepped foot in the ones that we started to look at. And I definitely didn't realize how, like, walking around in the, you know, body of the RV, if it's even slightly not level, you really feel it, even if the ground looks pretty level. So that was a surprise to me.
Yeah, it is. It is amazing how much just the slightest little bit will kind of throw it off. And what about, you know, if you guys working remotely, when you're planning where you're going to be, for each week at a time or a couple weeks at a time, how do you go about making sure you have good internet connectivity where you're headed to with, you know, without ever being there?
So that's a good question. So far, there's been a couple places where we looked up, we have Verizon and T-Mobile. So we've looked up the coverage maps.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's our source of internet. We have a router that runs off SIM card, cellular data SIM cards,
and it pulls whichever one has the best signal, so we kind of get to mm-hmm. choose between the two.
So we can look at a coverage map of Sprint or T-Mobile or Verizon, and see what kind of coverage we'll be getting in that area, and then adjust accordingly.
That's cool, because again, that's the, you know, the challenge is that people who live in a house and work remotely and are, you know, hooked up with an Ethernet cable or going to the office don't really, you know, think about it at times. So what have been, and I'm sure, you know, because every time Sandy and I have this conversation about what's been our, you know, most awesome memory so far, it's tough to pin it down. But, you know, what are some of your, you know, your best spots, your best memories, you know, since going full time?
It's ever expanding, as we definitely hard to pin one down, but if I had to say top spot campgrounds would have to be, Tupper Lake in upstate New York. It was right on a beautiful lake in the Adirondacks, really cool spot, really cool town. We got to do some cool hiking, in that area and did like a natural water slide and things like that. So anytime we can get in the water, we like those locations.
Mm-hmm. We stayed at a really nice site, kind of splurged and treated ourselves our second weekend, mm-hmm. and stayed on the lake in Lake Erie at Cedar Point and did that. And that was really fun. That site, we called it the Hilton of campsites.
Yeah, it was amazing.
It was crazy. We only got to stay one night because it was expensive, but we treated ourselves. So that was fun. And then I think you guys recommended Polar Caves in New Hampshire.
No, I'd actually I think it was Jacob's Brook.
Okay. That's where we went there. And then we did the polar caves in New Hampshire from there. And that was really, really cool.
Yeah. We loved the polar caves and Jacob's Brook campground. It was a really cool spot. Mm-hmm. We went to the pool. We actually saw a black bear while we were swimming in a creek on the backside of the campground. So that was pretty cool. The campground owners were pretty stoked about it. We sent them pictures and they were really happy about that because they hadn't seen one since they'd been there.
We didn't see any bears when we were there. But it is cool when you do, like yesterday we were going through the north unit of Theodore Roosevelt National Park, and one of the big things we wanted to see were some bison. And, you know, we were only probably 4 miles in, and Sandy's like, oh man, if we don't see these things, I'm going to be really disappointed. And we look up to our left and there is a whole herd, and then they start coming down and crossing the street. And we had to stop and took a little video that we put up on Facebook and Instagram of just this whole herd of bison just, you know, crossing right in front of us, which was so wild. And I mean, that's the stuff that, you know, you're just not going to get living in a home.
Right.
Definitely not.
That's awesome.
Can't even get that in a zoo or anything like that. Just that comes from being out there and being in the wild. It's awesome. That must have been quite the sight.
It was. I mean, again, just a once in a lifetime opportunity for sure. It was so cool. So what, you know, throughout this whole thing, what are some of your goals moving forward? Like, are you guys making a list of places you want to get to? How far out are you planning? How's that all working for you?
Do you want to?
We do have an ongoing list of like places that we know we want to go to. Whether or not we get to all of them, obviously, I don't know. We're going to start planning soon for 2022. Our goal is to get out west in 2022. As far as that goes, we need to get on it because I know campgrounds start filling up, and we need to get our national park pass as well. Mm-hmm. But typically, I do most of the scheduling because we have our jobs. You know, I schedule the laundry and the dishes. He does all the mechanical stuff and the driving. So we have our jobs, but I usually plan out about a month and a half to 2 months ahead of time. As of right now, that's what I've been doing.
5 to 8 weeks out, with an overall kind of plan of just doing a lap around the country and then going from there to hit any spots that we want to go to again or be at for a little bit longer, but at least try to make one full lap.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So obviously you're in a little different situation than we are. So to know you're 5 to 8 weeks out, that's pretty impressive because if we're 5 to 8 days out, we're pretty happy about that. Right now, I think we're 5 days out and we're ecstatic to know that we're where we're going to be in the next 5 days.
That's cool. Yeah.
It's a little bit different.
A little bit more spontaneous kind of thing. I would like to do that as we kind of get used to the systems and maybe, you know, find a little solar panel that we're able to use so we don't have to be hooked up. That's the main thing is just we have to kind of be at a campground hooked up to power Monday through Friday. So until we get a little bit more comfortable powering everything from small solar panel or something like that, we're not going to be able to do as much boondocking as we like. And, you know, wouldn't be able to stay anywhere. So we kind of have to have the campgrounds set up.
Yeah. We're not on solar yet either, but I know, a handful of our friends, we just volunteered with a group and there were several of them that had solar. So that it's definitely huge advantage, you know, when you're looking into those boondocking situations and some stuff like that. So I think in your situation, it would definitely be, you know, well worth checking it out for sure. And it's something that we'll definitely look into as we kind of move forward. And, you know, again, right now, I mean, Sandy and I are just putting on a lot of miles in general. I mean, our first year, it was our 1 year anniversary about 3 weeks ago, August 14th. And, you know, at that point we'd put over 22,000 miles on the rig, which, you know, again, there's a lot of moving, but we're kind of making notes, like you guys said, you know, places you want to go back to, you know, so it's kind of like we're kind of on like our scouting trip right now. And then, you know, like where we're at now in Madura, you know, we're already, you know, we'll be back here without a doubt, and we'll, you know, spend some extra time. So it is cool to be able to, you know, to do that sort of thing. So when you're explaining your roles, Alex, you did say that Pat's doing most of the driving or all of the driving. Is that what I heard there?
Pretty much. He does, I would say, 99.9%. Our system works better if when we're parking, I drive and he, you know, waves me. I don't know how you direct me and I go up on the blocks. Mm-hmm. It works better that way. And I've driven it to practice, but I've never driven it to go to or from a destination.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Alex drove it the first time we tested out the tow dolly with the car on it. Alex drove it around her hometown in West Virginia. Mm-hmm. So that was pretty cool. But then, yeah, she just rolls onto the blocks a lot easier than I do, and it's easier for me to direct her. Mm-hmm. So I pretty much get it where we want it and then just lay the blocks out and she rolls up on there. So
yeah,
it works.
Yeah, kind of bummed out. I was hoping you guys were going to say you're splitting the driving 50-50 so I could go back to Sandy and be like, look, see, she drives as much as as he does, but that's not the case. But no, truthfully, I got to be honest, as much as I tease Sandy about the fact that she does kind of what you do, Alex, where she'll back it up once we get to a spot or, you know, adjust us at a dump station or something like that. I actually really enjoy driving, you know, itself. I did a blog probably about 3-4 months ago where I just talked about how much I enjoy the actual drive. So as much as I bust her chops about it, I'm actually kind of happy with that role for sure. So you guys said that, you know, Chief has been taking some adjustments on travel days and stuff like that, but other than the travel days, how's he like in RV life?
He's absolutely loving it. We take him pretty much everywhere we go exploring. So after work, if we, you know, go to a hike to a waterfall or anything like that, he's coming along with us. He loves getting to walk without a leash in the woods. Sometimes we let him off the leash. There's no one else there. So he runs around. He has a great time. On nice days, he'll spend anywhere from 80 to 90% of the day just sitting outside under the awning or laying out, taking a sun bath or something.
We have a long line that we put him on. So he's got a little bit of a, you know, longer leash so he can roam around a bit in our site. But yeah, he loves being outside.
Yeah, he absolutely loves it. Definitely an outdoor dog.
Outside and a tennis ball, and that's all he needs.
That's Uke is the same way. He's been great. He loves getting outside. Unfortunately, in the national parks, a lot of the trails and stuff, you can't take dogs on. So like, you know, yesterday as we were driving around the parks and we'd get out, you know, at an overlook and just go on a, you know, little short trail to get some pictures and stuff. You know, he's looking at us like, whoa, man, what's going on? Like, be going with you. What's going on? So that's a little bit of a bummer at times. But other than that, he's loving it as well. And he actually, you know, has adjusted well to travel days. I mean, at first, you know, he was not good just riding in a car or a truck or anything like that, taking him to the vet or just taking him, you know, somewhere when we were at home on a walk. I mean, he was just, you know, go completely bonkers in the car or truck. And he adjusted. You know, at first I wasn't sure, you know, his best spot to be at. So Sandy would sit on the couch in the back and I was thinking that he would just kind of jump up and sit next to her and kind of hang out there. And he was just back and forth from, you know, up to the cab to me, back to her, back and forth the whole time. And finally, you know, this was when we were still in test run mode and we were up at our one daughter's house. Sandy got in the front of the cab and she's like, look, he's just going to have to figure this out because I'm not sitting back there, you know, all the time. He's just going to have to figure it out. It was like from that moment on, he came up and sat in between us and was like, this is perfect. You know, I got my one human to my right, my other human to the left, and we are good to go. And that first day that we traveled, when I said about going down to Virginia, he sat up there with us the entire time would not go back, didn't lay down on the couch or anything, just sat up there the entire time. Now, the next day, he probably started about 2 hours, and then he was like, you know what, you guys have this thing under control. I'm going to go back and lay on the couch for a little bit. So he'll go back, and like when he gets tired, he'll go back and lay down. Or a lot of times he just lays down. We still can't figure out how he gets in a little ball, you know, in that seat, you know, in between those two seats. And you guys know what it's like. And we were just messaging back and forth about how that space, because the engine gets so hot, you know, it's like, man, that, like, do you really enjoy? And I think, you know, the dog's just like, yeah, this is where I want to be, in between my two people, you know. I'll deal with the heat as long as these two are next to me.
Mm-hmm. That's the same thing here.
We've tried.
Deal with the heat, deal with the shaking and the noise. We were eager to see if he would walk around or find a good spot, or, you know, go to the back and, you know, jump up on the bed. If, like, we didn't want him, we don't want him up there, but see what he would do. But he doesn't move from that spot.
We've tried blocking it and putting something there to see where else he will go. And he freaks out even more, and then we feel bad. So we just let him sit there now. And yeah, he somehow fits himself. Mm-hmm. In that compact little space, but and will not budge. You can't get him to go anywhere else.
Mm-hmm. It's funny.
So funny. So what would your advice be to, you know, somebody regardless of age, who would say, you know, hey, this is what I'm thinking about doing. I'm thinking of selling all my stuff and, you know, cruising around in the RV and, you know, working remotely or work camping or whatever the case is.
I would say just do it. Just dive in. Just get into it. If you're even considering it, go for it, because you can definitely, anybody can do it.
You can do it.
Yeah. So if you're thinking that, you know, you might not be able to get rid of so much stuff or not have so many clothes or not, you know, shower in a nice big shower all the time, it'll work out. you'll get used to it. It won't be as bad as you think. So if you're thinking about it, just go do it. Worst comes to worst, you could stop. I don't think you'll want to.
No. It really makes you appreciate small things like laundry, air conditioning, you know, space in general, but not that we miss those things, but you don't realize how much you don't really need.
Like with
you know that much stuff.
Yeah, like if you think you need a, you know, 2-bedroom apartment and, you know, or a, you know, 3-bedroom, 4-bedroom house, you don't think you'd ever live in anything smaller, like you definitely can, and it'll definitely be all right.
So yeah. Just do it.
Yeah, I agree with that, because, you know, as we were getting rid of all of our stuff, and again, little, you know, different situation than what you guys were in. I mean, we were in our house for 20 years. It was 3,500 square foot house. And we just had so much stuff that we never used. Like, as we're selling stuff off, we're like going through stuff like, man, I haven't touched this in how many years, you know? So I think it does give you the appreciation of really understanding that, you know, all of that material stuff at the end of the day really doesn't matter, you know? And as long as you have someone that you care about and someone that you love that's with you the entire time, it just makes everything, you know, that much better, you know, without a doubt. So I've had so many people who've said to me, oh man, that's something that, you know, I hope to do one day. And I'm like, do it, you know, just do it. Don't wait, do it. Cause you know, I mean, the other thing that's really, it's kind of sad to an extent, but also, you know, very eye-opening, is since Sandy and I started to do this, and we've lost a lot of friends, have passed away. And it just gives you that understanding that, you know, don't put it off, you know, till next month or next year, because you don't know if you're going to be here next month or next year. Because, you know, regardless of your age, none of us are guaranteed tomorrow, you know. So go out and enjoy your life. Don't get caught up in, you know, all this stuff that people say we should be, you know, gathering up and, you know, stockpiling for no reason, and just go out and live your life, you know.
Definitely. Yeah. Cause, I mean, that speaks to another one of our main reasons for doing this, is that, you know, anything could happen at any given time, and, you know, stop, you know, there's no need to push it off. And might as well just,
why not
do it? Yeah, just do it now. So
that's awesome. So you guys are, you know, sharing your journey on Instagram, and understand you've just started the YouTube channel as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Some of the, you know, motivation to wanting to do that, to, you know, share your journey as you go through this with, you know, I get initially friends and family, but obviously that's grown to, you know, a lot more followers than, you know, people you've even met in person.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know. I think originally we wanted it to be one thing, and it's still that, but it's changed. I think originally we wanted it to be more of a YouTube channel and maybe mm-hmm. less on Instagram, but Instagram we're finding is more our thing. The YouTube we have a lot harder time with so far. So we're going to try to do YouTube and work on it and try to get better. But mm-hmm. that has been challenging, which we didn't expect it to be as hard as it has been.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're obviously trying to, you know, document stuff and take pictures and videos. So down the road, someday we could, you know, show our kids if we end up having them or anything like that, just, you know, have some sort of record. And, you know, if we're going to be taking the videos and pictures, we might as well, you know, put them on social media and share them with everyone else, you know, at any given time. So it's been to kind of create a scrapbook as well.
The digital scrapbook, so to speak.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. And that's cool, because that's one of the reasons why, you know, we decided to do this. And you know, I think I'd shared my story with you guys when we first connected on social media, is that, you know, my mom decided to do this in the mid 80s. Her and my dad were divorced. I was living in Pennsylvania. She was in Florida. And she decided she was going to quit a really good paying job. And she took a 1967 Plymouth Valiant at the time, took the back seat out of it, put a sheet of plywood in there and a mattress, turned that into her bed. So her feet would be down in the trunk and her head would be behind the back seat, and decided she was going to travel the country. And when she had passed and we're reading through her journals and, you know, all that sort of stuff, and just, you know, going through stacks and stacks of old Polaroid pictures and, you know, all this stuff, that, you know, when I finally got the itch to do it, I was like, you know, if we're going to do this, I want to share it in real time, you know, because mom didn't have the opportunity to do that. And as cool as it was to go through all that stuff when she had passed away, there was also a little bit of sadness that, man, to be able to share this journey with her would have been that much cooler. And, you know, of course we got postcards and we got phone calls and all that sort of stuff, but it's not quite the same. So, you know, there's, you know, so much bad stuff that goes on in social media to begin with. You know, it's nice to be part of the side that's, you know, throwing good positive energy out there to the world.
Yeah. Definitely. Yeah. That's very, very well said. Yeah, it's a really good point. You know, with the advent of technology and social media, it's, you know, brought a decent amount of, you know, bad stuff, but it also brings a lot of good stuff, being able to share family photos and stuff with people across the world. In real time is really cool.
And on the flip side, I've started writing in a journal, which I've never done before, some of our experiences. So we also have that in writing, like my own account, rather than what's on social media as well. So I've never written in a journal before. I don't know that I thought I was going to like it, but it's been really cool to do.
Yeah. Yeah. And Sandy actually journals, and, you know, she said the exact same thing that you just said, that, you know, she would never really consider herself much of a writer or anything like that, but just to be able to journal and do it, you know, I've always kind of been the writer, so to speak. So it's, for me, it's pretty fulfilling to see her, you know, kind of branching out and doing stuff that, you know, she hadn't done in the past. So, you know, when she says, look, I got to get caught up on my journal, I, you know, feel compelled to give her some space and go back in the other room and let her do her thing. So that's pretty cool. So do you think your journal will turn into anything more? Do you think it'll be a book in the future or anything like that?
I don't know. I feel like I'm good at writing my thoughts down, but I don't know if they're organized thoughts. I don't know if that makes any sense, but I don't know. That'd be a cool idea.
You always get help from someone.
That's true.
To organize it.
There's a lot of ghostwriters out there. A lot of ghostwriters out there for sure. So just
I think that would be an awesome thing to do.
Just food for thought. You heard it here first.
Yes.
So anything that we didn't cover that you guys want to talk a little bit about before we get to my final question?
I think I just want to mention what you were saying about Sandy journaling and not really always, and not thinking that she was going to journal. Just part of getting out of your comfort zone is one of the biggest things of doing the full-time RV thing in general. You do a lot of growing and you learn a lot about yourself, each other, and you know, the great country that, you know, we have around us. So just getting out of your comfort zone is pretty cool.
Yeah, it definitely is. I can attest to that. So that brings us to our final question. Like I said, the subtitle of the podcast is Many Little People in Many Little Places, and it comes from the opening lyrics of a song by Michael Frante, which go, when many little people in many little places do many little things and the whole world changes. So what are some of the little things that you guys are doing each day to help make the world a little bit better place? And you guys can choose which one wants to go first.
I'll go first. Ladies first.
Thank you. I'm going to steal something that my grandfather told us right before we left for our trip. We went to go see him. He helped us with a couple of the maintenance problems that we were having. And he said, leave every campground better than you find it. So when you leave, make sure it's clean, pick up after yourselves, and make it look better than when you got there. So we've kind of been going by that in every site that we've been in.
Yeah, just make sure it's clean for the next person. And then for me, anything, I have to steal something from that my mom always taught my brother and I, and it's kind of the golden rule of, you know, treat others how you want to be treated. So anytime I'm out and about, I always try to, you know, be really nice to people and things like that, whether it's like a cashier at a store or, you know, someone you're passing by on a dog walk, just, you know, smile and be nice to people. And then on the same token, I would say, since I have to do it twice a day, one of my biggest pet peeves is stepping in dog number two. So I always pick up after my dog 100% of the time. Sometimes I forget a bag and I'll run back to the RV and, you know, go get it just because I can't stand leaving it out there. So no one has to walk by and step in or see that. So that's one of the little things that I do.
And you're only doing that twice a day?
I do it a couple times.
Yeah.
You might have to trade dogs or something, because this guy does it twice before 10 o'clock most days, I think.
Oh, man. Good for him.
Yeah, no doubt. No doubt. But those are great. And I love this conversation. Just give a little shout out as to what your Instagram handle is again. I know I mentioned it at the beginning, and then what the YouTube channel will be. And do you guys have a website or not? I don't remember.
We don't have a website yet. It might be something we look at doing in the future, but our Instagram is RV_party_3. We're also on Facebook, RV_party_3, and our YouTube channel is RV_party_3 as well.
Cool. Pretty simple. Yeah. Pretty simple. So cool. I really appreciate the conversation, and I hope that someday we end up in the same campground or something, can hang out a little bit in real person. That's one of the things that we've really enjoyed. You know, obviously COVID had, you know, dampened that a little bit in the beginning when we first started traveling, because people were still kind of, you know, distancing themselves. But when you get into a group of people or you know, another pair of people who are like-minded, it's really, really special for sure. So I definitely hope that you know, somewhere down the road, the stars align and we find ourselves in the same neighborhood for sure. So really appreciate you guys taking the time. And for my listeners out there, be sure to check out my other blogs and podcasts at danclauser.com. Pat, Alex, again, thank you so much for taking the time to join me.
Thank you so much for having us,
Dan. We really appreciate it.
Hopefully we'll end up in the same spot someday.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah, we can't speak high enough for the RV community. Everyone's been so great to us, and you know, just, you know, the conversation that we've had tonight just goes to show you just that, pretty much. So
thank you again.
Thank you again.
No doubt, no problem. Looking forward to catching you down the road.
Yes, Yes, sir. Yeah.